Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. It is such a great privilege to be here in Florida, coming from the places where we have a lot of frost and snow and so on and so forth. So coming here is like an exile in the kingdom of God. So I have no reasons to judge anyone for liking Florida or living in Florida. Today in the morning, I would have this subject, open for me, is the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. Open for me, let me in, please. This is a subject that has two patterns. But before I set the stage for entering into the subject, I would like to inform you, brethren, and I think that you are very well in agreement with the fact that we are living in a very solemn times. Events that have occurred in the last 2-3 years awaken the world. In the last few years, people stopped traveling. Many liked to go to do tourism in Central America, Caribbeans, Hawaii, so on and so forth. And the globalists decided no traveling, no getting out of your cage, stay there locked up 2 weeks, no permission to go to church to pray and so on and so forth, under legitimate or illegitimate, reasonable or unreasonable reasons. But newly, those who are leading and ruling the global world, we call it in the Bible, Babylon the Great, yes? Brothers and sisters, the problem is not with the book of Revelation. The problem is not with the book of Revelation. The problem is not with the prophecy. The problem is with the courage and dignity to put the finger on the wound. To take the events, the present events, and apply them in the biblical prophecy. That takes courage. Either you say Davos, globalist, Vatican, or you say Babylon the Great, is the same thing. You take a contemporary expression for the rulers of the world and apply it and equalize it in the prophecy context. Newly, they are very much interested to rewrite the Bible. The knowledge in the world has increased tremendously. We have a ChatGPT. You can talk to the dead people now based on the AI. And here we do have one of the major counselors, Yuval Noah Harari, the senior advisor of the World Economic Forum of the chairman Nazi son Klaus Schwab. He says, for thousands of years, prophets and poets and politicians have used language and storytelling in order to manipulate and to control people and to reshape society, he noted. Now, AI is likely to be able to do it. So they want to make a Bible based on the AI interpretation. Look, I have no problem against the science. God forbid, I love science, but depends who handles the science. You have a knife in the hand of an innocent cook that cuts the bread, and you can have the knife in the hand of a murderer, yes? There is bloodthirsty. So science, it's monolithic in a sense, but science doesn't have mother and the father. But science can do good if it's handled by people with high level of morality, or can do evil if it's in the hands of someone that has personal interests. For instance, AI. ChatGPT won't give a joke about Mohammed when asked in Arabic, but ChatGPT will give a joke about Jesus Christ. I talked with an AI professional. I said, why is that they allow to have a joke about Jesus Christ? ChatGPT is asking, can Jesus score in the hockey game? No, because always when he wants to score, they will crucify him, they will nail him on the bars. Dirty joke, you know, about Jesus. Now, when you go and ask the same ChatGPT, do you want to make a joke about Muhammad? Look what they say. Did they say, no, I'm not allowed to make any joke about Muhammad. So why is this selection in the world of intelligence, artificial intelligence? You can mock Jesus Christ. You can do everything you want with Jesus Christ in the name of science. But when it comes to sensitive religion, like 1.2 billion Muslims in the world, you reframe yourself, your intelligence, and your science to offend a religion that has something to say in the final events of this game. Do you see, brothers and sisters, we are living in solemn times where disinformation, destabilization, disintegration, and destruction is the result of departing from the world, from the Lord. And that's why I believe that today we can, now I set the stage, I get in the subject. Today, brothers and sisters, we have to choose to let the Lord Jesus Christ in our hearts, because the time will come when we will ask Jesus to let us in. Now Jesus says, let me in. But there will be a time when we will ask Jesus, let me in, and it'll be too late. I have here an example. I don't know exactly if you remember, brothers and sisters. This is an earthquake, very terrible tragedy in Turkey. You heard about Turkey's earthquake last year. 67,000 people in 30 seconds gone, brother. 30 seconds, 67,000 people dead under the gravels. This is a picture that shows a man that is so disappointed. He holds the hand of his wife, and his wife is under the rubble. Do you see the picture? He's there. And as he was looking to her, how she's dying gradually, he called a journalist. They said, take a picture with me and my wife. And the journalist asked her, what did you do? And with tears in his eyes, the husband asked and begged his wife, let me in. Let me in to die with you. This is the way that Jesus is asking you today. Let me in and let me die with you. In another same similar circumstances, a little girl said, not let me in, come in to Jesus Christ. The journalists and the reporters said that this little girl was receiving a visit of a woman that was giving her food and water until you come. This was her testimony, because she was 12 days under the rubbles. And they asked him, how did you survive? I don't know. A woman came to me every day. We know that the angels can manifest themselves in a man aspect or a female aspect. Why did the angel came as a female? Because in Islamic world, if a man will have visited her, they would have disfellowshipped her from that Islamic religion. But if the angel came as a woman, which they don't understand, to do a service to a 12 years old girl, they don't have any problem. So you see, the intelligence of God is so brilliant that he wants to save any silly mind. He wants to save everybody. Let me in was the story. Brothers and sisters, last night we talked about blind, poor, miserable, wretched, and I didn't give you an explanation. And today, to cooperate the subject of last night with the subject of today, I would like to recap, why are we wretched? We are wretched because we know the truth, yet we fail to apply it in our lives to its full extent. We are miserable. Why? Because we hide the intent of our actions. We are poor. Why? Because we have wasted God's blessings. We are blind. Blinded. Why? We are blinded by self because we are unable to see the needs and the suffering of others. And we are naked because Jesus does not recognize an empty religion. And per our conversation, you know, we had faith. Last night we talked about a little bit faith. You have to talk faith. You have to live faith. You have to act faith that you may have an increase of faith. Amen? Beautiful. And then, continuation, Micah cooperates with the statement, or vice versa. This AGY statement cooperates with Micah 6, chapter 8. He has shown thee, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord do require from you? Do justly, love mercy, and walk afterwards humbly with thy God. Brothers and sisters, we have a pride issue.
If we do justice means we keep the commandments, Ten Commandments. That's why do justly means according to the moral conducts of the Ten Commandments.
And then the Lord says love mercy, meaning love grace. So if you have the law, respect the law, and if you give grace to others, you keep the law and the grace. You have the justice and the mercy. But then, in order not to be proud of this, the Lord says, after you keep the law and offer grace to others, walk humbly with thy God. That's the problem. To be perfect in the Lord and yet to see ourselves miserable in our eyes. It's a kind of a difficult task, correct? Now, I'm not a scientist, I'm not a doctor, but I discovered something very interesting in the scientific world. Before I read what I want to read, we do have this Revelation 3:20, which the Lord says, I stand at the door of your heart, I say, and I knock to the door of your heart. If any man hear my voice, open the door, and I will come to him, and I will sup with him, and he with me. In 1991, brothers and sisters, the scientists made an astonishing discovery. They discovered that every human heart has approximately 40,000, they say, so-called specialized cells configured in a way that creates a neuronal network in the heart. They are like brain cells, they say, but they are not in the brain. They are in the heart. Wow. You know what that means? These 40,000 specialized cells are called sensory neuritis. What they found out at what the scientists discovered is that these cells think independently of the cranial brain. Unbelievable. I don't know if it's true or not. I'm not a doctor, but I found this fascinating. I found this fascinating, brothers and sisters. And they feel and they remember independently of the cranial brain. And then what they say, what that means is that every experience I have, even this one that we have now an experience, I'm registering in two places. I'm registering in my mind and my cranial mind as well in my heart. So if we were having a trauma, it would be registered in both places. That's why we have a problem with the mind and with the heart. Many times people laugh, why does God want to change the heart? You cannot heal. I cannot heal if I don't have the mind changed and the heart changed. And the Lord Jesus says, I'm going to give you what, everybody? A new heart. And he will give us a what? A new spirit as well. So here is the concept. Their minds were given to God in this world. They served him with their heart and what, everybody? Intellect. And now he can put his name in their foreheads. Brothers and sisters, salvation, repentance, conversion must occur here and must occur where? In the heart. If we try to heal only in the mind, intellectually speaking, we don't obtain profound 100% conversion. We need the 40,000 cells to forgive as well. And that's why the most, by the way, I don't know exactly how much you know about this Ellen G. White, but I was an atheist, and the first time when I read a lot, brothers and sisters, trust me, all the Russian literature, European literature, American, everything. I was a student in Bucharest in Romania. I know people don't know much about Romania. I was born there. People in America know about Romania three things: Dracula, Nicolae Ceaușescu, and Nadia Comăneci. So as a student, we will read U.S. Constitution. And we were marveling how God created such a brilliant enactment for the best bastion of freedom that you can find on planet Earth. When the communists will find American literature in within our ranks, they will put you in jail. They will say that you are pro-American. And then, brothers and sisters, you understand, when I read the first time, someone gave me great controversy. Believe it or not, I didn't speak very much English at that time. I could not read properly the name of the author on the book. L.N.G. White, what is that? So the guy gave me the book. When I read that book, I felt that this person, I don't know who this person is. I was 16. I said, I want more books. Do you have more books? Yes, we do have more books. But I want from the same author. Nobody told me that E.A.G. White is a prophet of the Lord, but I was convinced by the power of the word. Man, this person, whosoever, I didn't know that he's a woman or a man. I didn't know who that is, but I was fully convicted. This person was inspired by God. Later on, I came to the conclusion that she is the most translator author of all times, either gender, after the Bible. Do you know that? It's amazing, brothers and sisters. And she recognizes 120 years before 1991, when the science discovered the 40,000 cells, she says, in order to have the seal of God in our mind, we have to give to the Lord what? Our heart first, and then our intellect. And then he can put on his name, on our name, on our forehead, his name, meaning his character. When we talk about the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross, when Jesus was on the cross, you were in his mind. Yeah, he didn't think about his suffering. He saw you today here. Jesus on Golgotha 2,000 years ago, he was looking to every one of you. Every one of you has a value in his heart. In that terrible Gethsemane, what a difference between the Garden of Eden, the Garden of Eden, and the Garden of Gethsemane. The Garden of Eden, full of trees, beauty, sunshine. And the Garden of Eden, full of demons that try to put the guilt of humanity upon Jesus Christ. Do you know, brothers and sisters, that Jesus, even though he had controversies in the world every day, he never felt guilty up to the terminus point when he stepped in Gethsemane. Desire of Ages, please read Desire of Ages. These two books centered me in the message. Great controversy balanced me or cleared my theology. Desire of Ages made me understand who my Savior is. We need both. We need a sound doctrines, but we need a sound, correct image of whom we worship. We worship a God of mercy and compassion and kindness and endurance. And when he stepped on Gethsemane, Desire of the Ages says that for the first time, he felt upon him a strange feeling. Guilt? He didn't know what guilt is. We know what guilt is, yes? Jesus didn't know what guilt is until that time. The disciples were looking to him, and Ellen G. White says, they saw Jesus many times depressed, but never like now. They didn't have courage to bother him. They were afraid. Jesus was perspiring blood. He could not walk on his feet. Thousands of mountains were on his shoulders. The mountains of our sins and our misery of the entire world. In Gethsemane, he met the devil again. In wilderness, Lucifer came like an angel of light with three lies. I came from heaven, and I heard that there is somewhere here on planet Earth, the Son of God, Jesus Christ. Who are you? You don't look like Jesus. I know how Jesus looks like, as I just came from heaven. If you are Jesus, that Jesus, make some miracles. And the Lord is answering with, it is written. Three times.
When he lost, when Lucifer lost the fight, the battle in wilderness, based on it is written. He didn't, in wilderness, he basically came with three lies, deceptions. But now, in Gethsemane, where he brings all the angelic host that fall from heaven on his shoulders. Billions of angels, fallen ones, obstructed the light from the throne of the Father to touch and be in harmony with Jesus.
And now he comes in garments of fallen angel and says, yes, I am the devil. Yeah, this is the moment of truth. I know you want to save these people in Florida. Yeah, it doesn't matter. All these people are evil, 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 evil. Yesterday, you had you fed 5,000 people. Those 5,000 people today will cry, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. For whom do you want to die? You healed 10 lepers, correct? 10 lepers? You healed them. One came back to you, Jesus, and said, thank you. For whom do you want to die? In few moments from now on, these three special disciples of yours, John, Peter, and who? Somebody else, and James, they will fall asleep. The most expensive sleep you ever imagined was the sleep of the three disciples in Gethsemane, brothers and sisters. And Lucifer tells Jesus, yes, I'm evil, but they are evil too. Let's make a 50-50 business. Go back to your father and let this world on my hands. They deserve this destiny. Tell me, was that a blank truth about who we are? Yes or no? Yes. But Jesus trembled before this reality. But he had you in his mind. He didn't feel on the cross later on all the torture on his hands. He felt, I cannot give up on you. I cannot give up on these poor people that came today in Florida to this humble, modest spiritual conference. But you may say, yeah. Jesus kept us in his mind. But how about his heart? Because we talk about 40,000 cells. What those 40,000 cells will say about you and me? His mind says, I want them. Are mine. But how about his heart, brothers and sisters? Those 40,000 cells in the heart of Jesus broke that red hair into pieces. The heart of Jesus was broken in two. The 40,000 cells told his mind, we are joining you. The mind of Jesus and the heart of Jesus were united and cooperating for your salvation. If you, as a mind of Christ, say, I don't give up on them. As a heart, we join you, and we died of a broken heart. In reality, brothers and sisters, one of the biggest stars discovered in recent years is Caenas Maduras. I even don't know why these people call this star Caenas Maduras. Cain, I assume that comes from Cain, correct? Caenas in Latin, Caenas, it's a plural of Cain, meaning the multiplication of Cain. Caenas meaning canes, many canes. Why did they call this Caenas Maduras? I don't know. Because when you look to this, they saw the sign of the cross. You know that. Maybe some of you have seen that in recent years. The cross of Christ was there on the firmament of heaven. We do have sufficient evidences to believe in our Savior, in Jesus Christ. Caenas Maduras has the biggest sign in the center of the universe, the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ. When the Lord Jesus was on the cross, brothers and sisters, in China, far away from Golgotha,
The Chinese people that were reading in stars and the moon and all these crazy things, they have the case of Christ related in what they say the Chinese while Jesus was on the cross. Yin and yang have mistakenly switched and the sun and moon were eclipsed. The sins of all the people are now on one man. Pardon is proclaimed to all under heaven. Wow. At that very time when Jesus was on the cross, Chinese Zoroaster or whatever spectrum of reading the stars recognized that a man died somewhere far away from China for the sin of how many men? All men. History of the Later Dynasty, Volume 1, so on and so forth. And they continue. In the day of Gui Hai, the last day of the month, there was a solar eclipse. The emperor avoided the throne room, suspended all military activities, and did not handle official businesses for 5 days. Christ dying on Golgotha impacted the greatest, oldest empire of the world, the Chinese Empire. Brothers and sisters, we do have evidences, sufficient evidences to believe in the Lord, our Savior. Amen? Amen. And then, eclipse on the day of Gui Hai, men from heaven died. History of the later Han, they have many, multiple reports in this respect. As we know, when Christ died, was darkness that covered the earth. Mark 15, verse 33. It is almost copy-paste of the report of the Chinese. From the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came over all land. 3 days after the eclipse, this was recorded by the Chinese astronomers. Look at this. During in the reign of Emperor Guanwu, one of the day of Big Yin, of the fourth month of Janwu, a whole rainbow encircled the sun. This is what the Chinese saw. They saw the sun encircled with a rainbow. Unbelievable, brothers and sisters. We do have evidences that Jesus Christ is real and he is true Savior that today is knocking to your door saying, let me in. It's late in the night. Let me in. Because in not one day, I will not knock to the door and that will be too late. You will knock to the door of my heart and I will tell you it's too late. What do you prefer today, brothers and sisters, young people? What do you prefer? To let Jesus in? Or you prefer, brothers and sisters, to knock to the door of Jesus when it will be too late? You know, this is another experience. This is microbiology. Tiny object, limonin. It's a sign of the cross. It's that something glue. I don't know what it is. But the scientists say that this limonin is the very something that holds the human body together. I don't know how, but you walk because of this. No human body will exist without this. One of the tiniest elements in the human body. So you have the microcosmos and you have the inner biology that shows that the signature of God as a creator is all over the places, brother. Do you remember Solomon? Solomon was a disaster, spiritually speaking. He says Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 12. I, the what, everybody? He's not the king anymore? Was he a preacher or was he a king? What do you think? No, you cannot be both. If you are a preacher, you are not a king. No, I might, as a preacher, walk as a king in a church. You may see me that. And God forbid, Brother Levi needs repentance. No. But if we are preachers, we are missionaries of the Lord, we cannot be kings. For 40 years, Jesus knocked to the door of the king. Solomon. Jesus was the preacher knocking to the door of a king. And after 40 years, Solomon got tired of being king, walking as a king, talking as a king, squeezing the blood of the poor people for every piece of silver, for his tyrant pleasures. After 40 years, he says, the years came where I found no pleasure in them. And when those years outreached Solomon, he got sick and tired to pay the bills to be a king. We, young people, you may do your pleasure today. You may do abuse your body, your mind. You don't sleep nights. No worries. In one day, you will pay the bill. But when you pay the bill, you pay all at once. Solomon, after 40 years, says, brothers and sisters, I decided to give up, to resign my throne. I don't want to be a king. But what do you want to be? I want to be a preacher. You see, brothers and sisters, what happened with Jesus knocked for 40 years to the heart of Jesus, Solomon. Let me in. And after 40 years, Solomon opened the heart and let Jesus in. And they switched the positions. Jesus comes in the heart. He became the king. And Solomon became the preacher. They switched the positions. As long as we are keeping Jesus out as a preacher, we are kings. We claim that we have the destiny of our lives in our hearts, but we don't. But we act as kings. But the day comes when you may hear Jesus whispering for the last time, please leave you. Please, Andre, please, whatever, John, Juan, whatever. Please let me in. Brothers and sisters, that time will be the last day we may hear. And Solomon says, I, the preacher, was a king. We cannot be kings and preachers. You know, I want to ask you something very interesting. Brethren, if through that door will come a man today in the church, and he will be destroyed by sin, and he will come here to share his life testimony. Dear congregation, I am a terrible sinner. I did terrible things. I would like to be baptized in your church and receive me like the littlest, the last member of this church. Well, the brethren will say, what did you do? What did you do? Because we love gossiping. Oh, we love gossiping. What did you do? Especially those evil elements. Well, I brought my children to fire. I worshiped Moloch, Baal. I did all crazy things. I had 700 wives and stuff. And my name is Solomon. We will put a standby, a hold. Can we receive a Solomon in our church, honestly? You know, I met a Muslim, Mehmet, a good friend of mine back in the time, and says, how dare you guys Christians elevate the Bible to the level of the holy book when you have all the crazy things that Solomon did in it? What kind of holy book is that? Do you realize that we cannot receive in the church a man like Solomon? And we read three of the books of the Bible from this miserable man. What an oxymoron is this? What a utopia? What a paradox? And let's change the cliche for a moment. Another man comes, older than Solomon, and he tells his testimony, his story. He says, I killed a man and I took his wife. I greatly repented. I am under the curse of God. I want to reconcile with the Lord Jesus. And I want to be received in the church. My name is David. Do you realize that you are reading 150 Psalms? Yes, theologians say that not all 150 Psalms were written by David. I understand. I agree. I don't dispute things. But however, they are called the Psalms of what? The Psalms of David. How come you cannot receive David in the church, but we read his Psalms? Jesus says, I knock to the door. Let me in.
Because the time will come. Brothers and sisters, personal reflection. I was in the hard times when I have learned that success can put me down. I was in hard times when I have learned that disappointments can lift me up. It was in the hard times when I had learned that in order to shine, I don't need to end someone else's light. Do you see yourself in that personal experience of mine? I did that, brother. And the Lord called me to order. The Lord told me, listen, you are not the savior of the world. There is a savior. Again, back to the spirit of prophecy. Don't wait to feel good about your decision. Say to yourself, I believe it. It is so because God promised. Then never turn back. From that day, you will be a new person. There is no way by which the heart may become holy, save through Christ, the faith in Jesus. Yet many think that repentance is a kind of preparation which must originate themselves before they can come to Christ. What if I repent today and I accept Jesus in my heart? Regret, a desire to change, abandon your evil ways. But this is impossible to occur outside of divine assistance. Is that true? Can we produce this without Jesus? So why you should waste your time looking to you, how miserable and dirty you are, and instead of looking to Jesus, how beautiful, how wonderful he is. He seizes, this is one of the most brilliant statements I found. He seizes you as completely good, no matter how sinful your life may have been. In fact, from that moment, Jesus' character stands in place of your character from his point of view. He seizes you as if you had never sinned at all. What a gift. Man, what a different religion than ours. Is that true? He seizes you as if you have never sinned at all. That's the God that I worship. The best way to help someone to bear the cross is bringing that person to circumstances that will reveal his limitations. And Ellen White confirms, teach them to bear the cross, for in bearing the cross will bear them. This is the great central theme of wisdom. Brothers and sisters, to be a champion is to believe when circumstances will tell you the opposite. To be a champion is to trust Jesus when everything inside of you tells you that you are abandoned. To be a champion is to accept Jesus when your feelings tell you that you have lost eternal life. To be a champion is to walk when you can't, when you have zero power, when you did not eat nor sleep for days. Then you may understand. I don't know exactly, I don't like sports. And in general, especially those that express durity and bloodshed. Jack Dempsey was the world champion in boxing. And a journalist investigated his life and asked him, Jack Dempsey, how in the universe you managed to be worldwide champion? And everything, when I studied your games, you were all down, knocked down. These men spend more time KO on the floor. And at the end, he managed to be a worldwide champion. And the journalist didn't understand. What kind of boxer are you when we see you only on the floor? Are you playing boxing or you sit down on the floor? And yet, you manage to become a champion. And he answers, a champion is someone who gets up when he can't. Today is the time for the sinners. No matter how many sins you have, brothers and sisters, boys and girls, it doesn't matter who you are. Don't tell me how many sins you have. Maybe I have more than you. The problem of yours is not sin. The problem is, do you want to get up? Do you want to let Jesus to enter in your heart? Jack Dempsey says, it was in 1920, before that recession, Great Recession of America. When I was young fellow, I was knocked down plenty. I wanted to stay down, but I couldn't. I had to collect the $2 for winning or go hungry. I had to get up. When you haven't eaten for 2 days, you will understand. You see, he was standing there to be beaten up for $2 because he didn't want to be hungry. Brothers and sisters, sinners are spending on the floor, being knocked down by the devil and his sins. But you can stand up exactly when you can't if you let Jesus in. I was knocked down by the devil. And when I met the Lord Jesus Christ, he touched my heart. I let him in my heart. When he was praying in Gethsemane, my heart was touched. When he talked to the people while feeding them, when he diagnosed the sick before healing them, when he was extending his forgiveness and repentance to sinners, my heart was touched when he suffered in humility. When the Father's face was hidden from him, when he was mocked on the Via Dolorosa, my heart was touched when he was forsaken by his disciples. My heart was touched when he was in pain on the cross, but he did not forget the robber next to him or the thief on the cross. My heart was touched in an irreversible manner when he died of a broken heart, thinking of me and thinking of you. Brothers and sisters, as a conclusion coming close to this, if you don't want to make waves, then follow the crowd. Go wherever the crowd goes. Do whatever the crowd does. Eat what the crowd eats. Dress the way that the crowd dresses. Speak the way the crowd speaks. And after you neutralize your uniqueness, you will remain a mediocre shadow. People don't talk about losers. People talk about winners. If you want people to talk about you, get the courage. Stand up when you can't and become a winner for Christ. Amen. I do believe that if you are a doctor, don't forget that he is a great physician. If you are an astronomer, don't forget that he is the morning light. If you are an architect, he is the cornerstone. If you are a baker, he is the bread of life. If you are a carpenter, he is the door of heaven. If you are an electrician, he is the light of the world. If you are a farmer, he is the seed that crushed the serpent's head. If you are a geologist, he is the rock of ages. Amen. If you are an emperor, he is the king of the kings and the lord of the lords. If you are a lawyer, he is the lawyer in front of the father. If you are an optometrist, he is the one that opened the eyes of the blind. If you are a student in the truth, you are a traveler, he is the good Samaritan. Jesus is Jesus, is Jesus, all in all. Amen? And if it's so, today, look at him. Don't look at you. Talk about him, don't talk about you. Talk to him, test him, and after all, rest in him. Brothers and sisters, I remember I was in Florida in 2015, and at midnight my mother called me. My father was an atheist. He struggled with smoking, alcohol, cigarettes, unbelief. My mom came to the Lord after I got converted. But he never. And now it's time for him to die. And my mom called me and says, please come home because he's dying. He's in a hospital. I wrote quickly the most beautiful letter I could ever write to my father. I sent it via email to a good friend of mine that was a student in university in the city where my father was hospitalized. And I said, please, please go and read his book to my father. I took the first flight and I arrived. But by the time I arrived, my friend did not manage to receive the email. My father died in a Sabbath morning. At 10 o'clock. Before he died, he was talking to all the students in university. Boys and girls, don't do what I have done, because how much I would like to live one more second, and it's too late for me. He had tremendous regrets that he didn't accept to let Jesus in. I arrived home, and I felt like a man like a preacher, I felt that I abandoned my father. For 25 years I left, or maybe more, I left my country. And I thought I was tortured by my mind. If I would not have left my country, maybe my father would have been saved. I don't know. But when the conscience pushes you, it's terrible pain. Brothers and sisters, at his funeral, I read to my father, dead, the letter that he did not receive while he was on the dying bed. Today, after so many years, I'm looking to myself as a miserable man. And a voice keep telling me, you are an evangelist. What kind of evangelist are you? I went to baptize all kind of nations and cultures, and you could not save your father. What kind of fisherman I am? I will leave with my conscience affecting me. I did not do much for my father. So, boys and girls, if you still have parents around today, just think of the fact that you can say beautiful words as long as you have parents, mothers and fathers. Brethren, I would like to conclude with a verse that is the science of salvation. In fact, Jeremiah 17 is the worst chapter speaking about men. Cursed be the man who trusts the man, yes? Whose heart is deceitful and so on and so forth. Yet there is one single Bible verse that is the beauty, the pearl of the Old Testament. Heal me, O Lord, and I shall be healed. Save me, and I shall be saved, for thou art my praise, or thou art my glory. Brothers and sisters, it is my wish and prayer that today, if you feel impressed by the Lord to let him in your heart, before we conclude this sermon, I would like to pray with the greatest sinners from which first I am. Young men, girls, brothers and sisters, friends, if you would like to pray together with me to ask Jesus one more time to touch our hearts, I would invite you to come in front. I would like to appeal to your heart. Don't let tomorrow to pass away. Today is the Sabbath. Tomorrow is the last day of the year. If you feel impressed by the Lord Jesus Christ, please come in front and I will pray with you. Don't forget about that. You are a sinner. While we are singing the last song of the conclusion of this service, 666, if you feel impressed by the Lord Jesus, please come. I would like to merge all the hearts that will come here to talk to Jesus, to unite this beautiful bouquet of flowers, and to come and to pray and to open the heaven and to receive the forgiveness of our sins. So before we pray, I would invite all those wounded hearts to join me in prayer. If some of you feel impressed by the Lord that has to do some changes in his life, I would invite you to get the courage to stand for the Lord Jesus Christ. If you feel that you have a daughter or a son that is prodigal, if you feel that something must change in a relationship in your family as a husband and wife, if you are a child whose parents are not in the faith, come and unite your hearts with me in prayer. Today, the heaven is open and Jesus has decided to forgive all our sins. You go back lighter, infinite lighter than you came. Empty of sins. Jesus Christ is telling to the Heavenly Father, Father, I want all this to be with me in the kingdom that you gave me forever and ever. And we pray for our children. We pray for our spouses, husbands and wives. We pray for our parents. We pray for our neighbors. We pray for our visitors and pray for our neighbors and enemies as well. Brothers and sisters, today is the day when we can open our heart and let Jesus in. Because he loves you incommensurably. His smile is the best melody you can ever hear. His words are the best poetry you can ever read. The universe is full of surprises for all of you today. And today Jesus is glorious. Look at the army that he has, sons and daughters of God, that will be on the glassy sea with Jesus before the Heavenly Father. I thank you so very much for your dignity and your courage to accept Jesus in your life and yielding with an act of desperation. Lord, I let you in. Give me salvation. Save my beloved ones. Let us pray, brothers and sisters. Let's kneel down together. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before thy throne of grace with these brilliant pearls, these jewels that are here, the hearts of the brothers and the sisters, the hearts of the young and old, the hearts of the strangers and the visitors, the hearts of the wounded ones. And we come to say with Jeremiah, heal us, O Lord, and we shall be healed. Save us, O Lord, and we shall be saved, because you are our glory. You are our hope. Today, you know the voice. You know the language. You know the transcript of every single heart that is right here, right now. You can echo and take every single tear they shed on their cheeks. You are the one that promised that you will listen to the inner cry of their hearts. Great sinners, as we are indeed, but we pray to the one that is proportionally, infinitely much greater Savior, Jesus Christ. Dear Heavenly Father, forgive us for everything that we have done in the past. Take the load from our shoulders. We let you in our heart and be the king. Be the king of our hearts. Let us be the preachers like Solomon. We want to do the switch. We want to let you to be the king and us to be the missionaries. We ask you for the congregation. We pray for all these young men and young girls, young daughters. We pray for the children. We pray for those that are prodigal sons. We pray for those that are lost in the church. We pray for those that are lost sheep. We pray for the one that is lost coin. Lord, we pray for every single heart here. We know that the days are counted and the time is reversing fast. We want to be saved and we want to be certain of it. We are great sinners, but we recognize you as our Savior. We love you, Heavenly Father. We miss you. And if there will be a time when you will give us a chance, and all these brothers and sisters that kneel down with me to talk to you for a few seconds, we have two requests. To give us permission to lay our head on thy chest and to hear thy divine heart that is beating for us. That heart that was broken on Golgotha. We want to give us permission, Heavenly Father, that the tears that we have on our cheeks today to be the tears that we can wash your feet in thy kingdom. These are the two requests. To ask you to allow us, enable us to sing in a celestial language the song of Moses and the song of the Lamb. We have no money. We have nothing to buy gold, silver, white garments, and the Holy Spirit. But we sell ourselves to you today forever in an irreversible manner. We thank you because you are our Father. And Jesus, your Son, is our Savior and our brother. We love you. We miss you. And we're looking forward to see your beauty in all its fullness, now and forever. Amen.